violating 1 John 2:15-17. They love the world, the things in it, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh. Give me my pleasures. whose mouth is full of curses and bitterness means, in Psalm, you know, that's Psalm, you know, it refers to Psalms 10, verse 7, indicates that man's mouth, which is created to speak the truth of God and praise Him continuously, has been perverted to speaking of Satan and praising Him through cursing and bitterness. Isn't that what's going on in America right now? Look at, you know, you listen to the news. It's all perverted.
It's bullshit.
The liar in chief is always, you know, telling us what we're supposed to believe when we know it's lies. You know, just everything that goes, and then they don't have the other side, the supposed our side, Republicans. See, we're out on the far right. Republicans, unfortunately, are about here. Okay, you know, they're wishy-washy. You know, most of Democrat people are about here. And then the Democratic Party is about here, and full-blown communism is there. Okay, that's how America is politically, and just keeps getting worse and worse. Any wonder why I believe we're about 19 months away from the rapture of the church? Yeah, we'll find out when we get closer. Bible says, "Well, no one is at the door; you know, no one is as close as your front door." Things just progressively just keep getting worse and worse. It probably doesn't matter who the next president is. There won't be a country left when Obama leaves. Yes.
Is there one specific thing that you think will happen that will show us that it's at the door?
It's a series of things that are going on right now.
Okay.
You see the uprise of Islam, mm-hmm. okay, in the world. And as I said in my outline, mm-hmm. you know, they're not going to go along with the one world government. Mm-hmm. Okay, and you know, nobody else is saying this yet. You know, and I'm waiting for somebody to, you know, give me a confirmation because remember, no prophecy is of a private interpretation. Mm-hmm. Right now, this is probably a private interpretation. Not to say that I'm wrong,
right?
But we see that Islam is, you know, and, you know, radical Islam is, and they're all getting radicalized. And this is why in Revelation 9, where the angels come out of the great movie Euphrates, they're leading an army. Doesn't say they're men. Mm-hmm. I don't believe for a minute that there's 200 million man army coming from coming from China. Okay, mm-hmm. It doesn't say they're men. They're leading the army, so they're leading demons. Mm-hmm. And God says to everyone, we should get to kill 7 people. And that wipes out the whole. That wipes all of Islam. So that for two reasons. Number one, the Antichrist can solidify his power. And number two, that the Jews only have to look to the Antichrist. They don't have to look with both.
Right.
That would be too much. God says he never puts more in you than you can handle. Mm-hmm. Now we put more on ourselves than we can handle.
Yeah.
Okay.
Totally.
Because we have. If we're living in the world, we have a tendency to take one or two or three too many steps, and we get ourselves into trouble. Okay, we do it to ourselves. God does not do it to us. Right. So go ahead.
I was going to say.
Yes, Martha.
No. Why do you think somebody needs to give you the confirmation? Are you talking
what?
About?
I'm talking about other people saying, other prophecy teachers saying the same thing.
Oh,
okay.
Oh, I see.
Many, you know, you got Hal Lindsey still saying, you know, it's coming from the Far East.
Okay.
You still got Jack Van Epi's this way for you guys. Still saying it's a 200 million man army from China. Okay, which they already have right now, by the way.
But have you put this out?
No, I haven't.
Why
I haven't sent it.
Be the first
I haven't sent it to.
Else?
Are you gonna sit by me?
I got through a lot.
It's for Grandma March. I know. We see everything falling apart, and I fully expect Comrade Abomination to wipe out America before he leaves office, sometime after the November election next year. And before he leaves office, January 20th, 2017, I expect him to finally collapse the American society, economy, and leave nothing for the next president. And America, we know, has to go away to join the one world government because we're still more affluent than anybody else because we still have that mindset up here, okay? America will not join it. and how can the Antichrist have his power if America's still around? And what better way than to have, like I said in the, in the outline, what better way to prove that you are the Antichrist than to wipe out the most powerful nation on earth as president, and then go to, and see, he's, the report came out, 6 months, a year ago, that he's tired of being president. Okay, he's ready to be the world king. Okay, the king of the world. And isn't that what the Antichrist is? All right, he's ready for that. And we see the demonic nature of everything that he does. And he's a little bit of everything. He claims to be Christian when he's really, Muslim. He claims to be black when he's half white. Okay, all the claims he makes are on both sides. So he's part of everything. And isn't that where the world is? Part of everything. So it's all fitting in. Unfortunately, is it unfortunate? They were only a few months away from spending eternity in heaven. We don't have to worry about this world anymore. Okay. The point was saying that it's very close, and giving proofs. You got Judah ben Samuel's prophecy. Everybody ought to look that up and read it for yourselves. I've got it in the outline. And then the 108-year-old Jewish rabbi that died in, was it 2008? Okay. With the Sharon prophecy that he said, and he just died. The Messiah was coming back shortly after his death, after being in a coma for, eight years? Okay. Just before he gave the prophecy, just about the time when he gave the prophecy, he went into a coma. And he just got done dying. So, all kinds of things are pointing to it. We just don't know exactly what it is. But I think it's, I think it's going to occur on Feast of Trumpets, because we're changing the wink of an eye at the last trump. So, we should be looking for it, every Rosh Hashanah. Okay, Feast of Trumpets.
Yeah.
We should be living for it every day.
Yeah.
And, but the main point is we only have a little bit of time to evangelize friends and relatives. If you want a full family reunion when you get to heaven like I do, you better be doing what you can. And if you can't reach them, then pray for God to send another Christian to befriend them. Remember, Jesus was not accepted in Nazareth, right? Because he was too close to them. Well, we can be too close to our relatives. Like my three sisters don't speak to them. Okay?
Yeah, well.
Okay?
I know.
Been too close for too long.
But that's everywhere,
Right.
It's
so,
my family. Yeah.
Right. So hopefully, before it's too late, that somebody will be able to reach them. Now, if they don't make the first rapture of the church, as explained, I see four of them because we have a loving God. That they make the second one with the two witnesses, Revelation 11:12. Come up hither. Same words as Revelation 4:1-2. Okay, we're raptured there. There is much time, but hopefully they will see it. And this I would believe, with that second rapture after 3.5 years with the two witnesses, will be the end of the Gentiles being saved. It will virtually be all Jews from that point on.
Where is Perry Stone right now?
He's in Cleveland, Tennessee.
I know that.
The other Cleveland.
I can watch TV.
He and I are very close on most of this.
He hasn't come to your assumption.
No, and he is of the opinion that the seventh seal judgment is an opening for the trumpet judgments. Seventh trumpet judgment is an opening for the vial judgments, because he's not noticing that it's wrapped up at the same time with other things.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that I think, as I wrote, put in the write up, I believe God did that to show us the timing of it. Mm-hmm. Okay, that when you have the silence in heaven for the space of half an hour in Revelation 8:1-2. And then you have the trumpet judgments open, and then they die. That's when the judgment occurs. The real judgment there is that God is no longer going to send prophets to warn people of what he's going to do. You never see another prophet warning them. Now, you have the angels flying in mid-heaven telling them don't take the mark of the beast, but it's not telling them what God's going to do. Okay? So when you read Revelation 11:6, it says one of the reasons why the Antichrist killed them is they turned the water to blood, and that is one of the seven trumpet judgments. They just got done doing it. Okay, so they don't have drinking water. okay? The world, they want blood. Look at abortion here in America. All the blood that's been shed, all the babies that have been ground up in, put down garbage disposals so they can save money, so they don't have to, worry about, even sending them to the landfills that just came out. Okay, they've been anything to save a buck. 1 Timothy 6:10, the love of money is the root of all evil, and that's their god, money. So we're getting closer and closer. We see this stuff happening. We see everything lining up. We see that America is going away, with the quantitative easing. How many? You put about $1 trillion or more into quantitative easing. All right. All you have to do is say, in the bond market, which supports the stock market. All you have to do is say, I want it back. Collapse right then. The end of America as we know it. And we will probably have to live through that. Now, if he does that sometime between, next November, 11 months away, less than 11, away until, February, until January 20th, 2017, 13 months from now, we will have, and if the rapture occurs in September, Rosh Hashanah, if I remember right, is, Feast of Trumpets, starts at dusk on September 20th and runs until dusk on September 22nd. Okay, so when I say a high probability, I'm not saying that's it, but I'm not even saying a day because it transcends 3 days. Mm-hmm. Now, it's 2 full days to the Jews. Remember, day started dusk for them. So it's 2 full days for them, but it's 3 days on our Roman calendar. All right? So we're getting, close and we see it. Friends and relatives, leave them with the information on the rapture of the church. Print off a copy of what I gave you, Pass it on, Got it on emails, send it. Yeah. I don't care. The more people that get the information, the better. We should not want to see anybody go to hell, even our worst enemies.
I was at a prophecy conference in the fall, and one of the speakers there was Southwest Radio Church.
Okay.
And he said none of this can happen until the 10 nations are formed.
It is not 10 nations. You mean the 10 geographical areas?
Yeah.
Okay, that happens after we leave. Okay, or about the time we leave. See, that really, the Bible doesn't talk about that until the second half of the tribulation period. So timing-wise, we don't have to worry about it. All right, it is going to happen. That's why there is no border fence to stop the Mexicans and whatever else from coming in. That's why Comrade Abomination is like my last newsletter. He's bringing all the Syrians, and you got terrorists in there to create more turmoil in America. Okay, just any uprising. We have never had, before he took office, we did not have these racial problems that we do today. They're getting worse and worse. That's why the Black Lives Matter, and why I was at Mizzou, 2 weeks ago, rhetorically asking them, if black lives really matter, prove it by saving your own children. They're the ones keeping the planned predators and the other abortion clinics open. When I'm at preterm, where Lakeisha Wilson died, a year and a half ago, or a little longer, three-quarters of the women that go in are black. It's in a black community, just like 79% of the rest of all the clinics, to get rid of the black community. Because Margaret Sanger hated people of color, mainly blacks. Human weeds that need to be plucked up. We got to get the Negro pastors to ministers to go along with us. And they are. They are.
And they stupid.
Yes.
They're evil.
So it's all lining up. It's not quite there yet. But we as Christians should be seeing this when people like me who have been given the understanding of what end time prophecy is. Seeing how most of you came, we read it worth a 3 year, 3 years to do the class because there's so many verses. You guys should be seeing it when I reference something. That something should pop in your mind, different verses and how it all relates and how it's all being set up. When God says, we'll know when it's at the doors, in Matthew 24, we should realize we're seeing everything getting set up. There isn't much time left in this world. Something that was never said on Star Trek, beam me up, Scotty. It's going to be beam me up, God. Beam us up, God. Okay? while all hell breaks loose on Earth. You know, it's time for his judgment to come. One, you know, and one of the main, you know, there's just all kinds of different things. Look at America going away. America's had the money to supply, to keep missionaries going around the world. We're now walking away, and the number of missionaries is getting less and less and less. All right? And there's, and God has always had people that he could move to do the Great Commission. You know, Matthew 28, 18 and 20. Now there is no place to go. When America goes, that's it. There's no place God can go. You know, even though there are Christians around the world, third world countries are getting evangelized. You know, that's where, you know, as America's number of Christians goes down. As the older people that are Christian die off, the younger ones are being born, they're not being evangelized. Okay, the church isn't doing its job. They're too busy compromising with the world. But in third world countries where they're being persecuted, like, you know, in the Middle East, you know, that's kind of why Comrade Abomination doesn't let Christians in. You know, that's Muslims in. And the ones that have come here, he put them in concentration camps. So, you know, we just, we know where he really stands. But Christianity is growing around the world in third world countries. That's the great revival the world's talking about. Okay, that the Bible's talking about. At the same time, there's a falling away. America's the one that's falling away. Okay, so we have both going on. We should all be able to see this stuff. Finishing the commentary, verse 14. You do not have to teach a man to curse. It is a common expression of his bitterness within him that is rooted in personal sin. Verse 15, Romans 3. Their feet are swift to shed blood. One of the verses I use in my newsletter. Look how fast they are to go to abortion clinics when you find out there's a pregnancy. Okay? You know, like I put in the last newsletter at Mizzou, you know, my body, my choice. Well, that implies just one. Well, didn't the, aren't, you know, when a man and a woman, you have to say it that way these days,
yeah.
have sex, you know who's going to get pregnant, okay? By her agreeing to have sex, she is given permission for that baby to be there. She made her choice. And of course, they, you know, it should be my body, my choices, okay? And because I put it in my newsletter, it'll probably get to some pro-abort.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. They will probably change it now. Now, I noticed that happen. What was it? Around 2004, I was doing Ohio State, and they Planned Parenthood just came out with new shirts, and they were now we'll get the questions. And their shirts were red, the color of blood. And they said Planned Parenthood on them. And I made a note in my next newsletter how their red shirt T-shirts matched the blood of the children on the display. The next time I saw them, they're all pink. Okay, and they've been pink ever since. So. I'm in Romans 3. Okay? So their feet are swift to shed blood. We see at the abortion clinics how fast they are to get in there. You know, preterm was just overloaded, Friday when I was there. It's incredible how many babies they murder. Commentary. Repeats the verse and says, wrong one. Paul now turns his attention not to men's words, but to his deeds. Is that what we're talking about? You know, just what they do. You can apply this a whole bunch of different ways. Obviously, being a pro-life church and being out in the clinics and the only church that has pastors that go out to them here in the area. We are very aware of it, and, we do the Isaiah 1:18, come let's reason together with other pastors, but they don't come, okay? Oh, I'm not called to do that. Well, you know, I don't see my name on it either, okay? But when they get to heaven, God's going to say, God's going to ask them, what were you doing when they were killing my babies? You know, the guy right across the street, he's starting to fall away, okay? You know, King James Bible is no longer any good.
What is he using?
Oh, I don't know what he's using now. But he, he got on the radio on his radio program, and because he sat on the radio, and that sent a friend of mine up the wall who was trying to help him, and you know, he started saying there's errors in the King James Bible.
Yep.
Well, in English, it's as close as you can get, but he was saying other Bibles were better.
Derek Noel.
What? Yeah. So, I wasn't going to give names. You know, because Ken was videoing this for some idiotic reason. Quoting from Isaiah 59:7 and after, the feet which were created to carry the gospel to the end of the earth have, in every era of history, readily carried men's violence to commit injustice and war with his fellowmen, Proverbs 1:7-19. If I remember right, history shows that the world has only been without war for about 280 years of the 6,000 or so that we've been around. That's it. Okay? Man left to his own devices, wants whatever he wants. Whatever he can take from somebody else, whatever he can get, if he thinks he's got power over the other, one people group thinks they got power over another people group, they go after him to wipe them out and take what they got. So much for the eighth commandment, thou shalt not steal. Because that's basically the reason why they do it. The United States is the only country in the past has ever given its men and its money and time and whatever for the freedom of others and then walked away. Okay, that's why the United States has cemeteries all over the world, right? With our men who have died in that country. And I think it was France a number of years ago told the government that maybe it was back under FDR or something. Get your men out of here, okay? We don't want your military men. We don't want them here. And he said, does that mean we have to move all those graves, all the men that fought for you? I think it was after World War II. He was referencing World War II. Okay, things like that. But now that America is going away, and we got a guy in the White House that hates us. And hates America. How long did communism try to take us over, and the Muslims did it in a matter of 10 years? We got a Muslim in the White House. Not even that. 7 years after 9/11. Okay. Verse 16. What? Somebody had a comment? Okay. 76. Destruction and mercy are in their way. Misery are in their way. They're going to be, God is going to destroy them. All these ungodly people that have their own trinity, me, my, and I, all they care about themselves, or the countries that all they care about is them and what they can get. Judgment day is coming. Matthew 25, 31-46, where it talks about the judgment of the nations. Didn't you do this, that, and the other thing for the other people? Primary meeting, when you read verse 31, 32, it says the judgment, Jesus Christ is judging the nations. It is after the tribulation period, when he's going to let them know whether or not they're going to be allowed to be around or not, or if they're just completely taken over. The secondary meeting is on a personal basis. Did you give them clothes? Did you give them, when I was naked, you clothed me. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me water. Putting the ungodly on his left-hand side. The primary says is nations. Now, secondarily, it's individuals, too. Okay? Most pastors are only using the individual reference to that. What? Well, aren't we seasoned Christians?
Yeah. Oh.
Okay, poor Joe. So he repeats the verse again. He says, the 12th charge in the apostles' indictment list is not only what man is seeking, but what he shall certainly receive if he continues in his unrighteous path. And most people don't care. Even the ones that even think about God, I'll worry about that when I get old and I'm ready to die. Then I'll accept Jesus. So I can live my life the way I want to because I want to enjoy it. The me, my, and I doesn't work that way.
He's not promised to nobody.
calamity and misery always follow the sinner's futile search for happiness apart from Jesus Christ. They will live the life they want, the way they want, but they're not going to be happy. And it'll be, and as it says here, it'll be futile. They'll die before their time. They'll, God will give them disease. God will give them whatever. Any, he doesn't want anybody to perish. But we all have the right to choose. And God comes to everybody at the earliest opportunity for them to accept, when people do accept, and he comes at the most opportune time in a person's entire life when they will accept. And if they don't, why should he ever come again? Okay, because he knows the end from the beginning. So why should he ever come again? So, some of the verses for eternal security is from God's point of view, not man's point of view. We don't necessarily know. Remember when I do the squishy middle, we don't know the people in between. And we know people out here, and the writer's saying, we know people out here are lost, but between the thumbs, most of America is in that place. We don't know whether they're saved or not. They don't necessarily have the evidence that they're saved for us to know. If they're out serving God, chances are they are. But how many people say, I got my ticket to heaven, that's all I care about. They don't care about anybody else. And if you don't care about anybody else, how can you really be a Christian? People don't understand that. Verse 17. And the way of peace they not known. We as Christians will have peace that surpasses all understanding, right? We should all have that peace. If we don't, then we got to figure out, we need to figure out why you don't have the peace. Even in turmoil, when things go on around you, you still have that peace. That's a hard concept for some people to pass. How can you have peace when there's turmoil going around? But stop to realize, 100 times in the New Testament, one of the main verses is 2 Peter 3:12. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you will be persecuted. 100 verses say persecution, affliction, suffering, and I think tribulation. But it's tribulation from the earth, it's not tribulation from God. God's tribulation only comes on the ungodly. We can get tribulation from the world. It all means the same.
Exactly.
We are going to be persecuted in this world because we are Christians. Yep. Look at what's going on in the Middle East. Okay, the Christians are being crucified. Okay, they're getting their heads chopped off. They're being persecuted for the faith, and they're going to have great rewards in heaven for going through that. Okay, they deserve it. For us, Luke 12:48b, where much is given, much is required. The word required means right now. And how many people are basically saying, in evangelical Pentecostal churches, maybe some of the fundamental churches like us, they're saying, God, just take it out of my rewards in heaven. Let me live my life the way I want to. Chances are they're even there. Yes?
It's 2 Timothy
3:12. I said first. Oh, yeah.
2 Timothy 3:12.
Yeah, 2 Timothy 3:12 is. I thought you said 2 Timothy. Okay.
You said Peter.
Okay. Yeah, okay, yeah, 2 Timothy 3:12 is, yes. Sorry about that. Thank you. That's why I love comments here, and I don't do sermons. Yeah. I have people in his hand all the time. We should have the peace knowing we're going to have the tribulation. Look at, Paul and John, Acts chapter 5, I believe it is. They're pulled into the Pharisees and for preaching Jesus, and they were whipped and said, "Don't you ever do that again?" And they praised God that they were worthy enough for persecution. Nobody likes pain. Nobody wants to be persecuted. But normally in America, it's just words. Okay, look at our brothers and sisters around the world. With the physical, etc. We should be. We should have that peace. The rest of the world does not have that peace. There is a God-sized hole in all of us, a Holy Spirit-sized hole, I should say, in all of us that the Holy Spirit has filled. They're trying to fill that hole with something else, and you can't fill it. No matter how much stuff they get, guys, flat screen TVs, women, your shoes and purses and clothes and whatever else. Guys, try to even it out. Cars and
livery.
None of us can fill that hole. Only the Holy Spirit can fill that hole. The ungodly try to fill it with materialism and going to concerts and, you know, other stuff like that, you know, to pleasure themselves. And it just never satisfies. You know, I don't know how many of you can remember your BC days, and, you know, I never got satisfied with it. You know, and that's why I was a very unhappy person.
Well, the situation, I mean, just an example this past weekend, the Star Wars movie came out.
Yes.
In one day, they took in $52
billion. 54.
Oh, wow.
54. Yes, one day.
One day.
Right.
Did you see the video where they had a breakdown of this movie projector? The people went crazy. They started moaning. Yeah, they started moaning, crying. People were jumping up and screaming. Oh
no!
Oh, and they were they thought they were going to have a nervous breakdown. These people, hundreds of them.
Yeah. And it's all
for shit. Sad.
Yeah. Okay. You know, none of it's ever going to happen. It's true.
No.
You know, God says, you know, 2022. God says about the circle of the earth. He doesn't sit over. Oh, doesn't necessarily say he sits over the whole universe. Okay, with all kinds of different worlds, we are the only world. All right. They're going to find life on another planet. Okay. Now, we don't know. I should say this. God wrote the Bible for us to know what we need to know now. And then once we got into the millennial kingdom, God became very, very vague. In Revelation 21:22, God got very vague as to what's going to happen in the future. He lets us know what we need for now to get saved, and then we can worry about that stuff later. We don't need it here on earth to know what's going to happen in the millennium, you know, beyond the millennial kingdom. We rule and reign with them for 1,000 years. Hang on. We rule and reign with them for 1,000 years, but then mankind is going to end in the sinful nature of man. The ungodly are going to go to the lake of fire. You know, in Revelation 20, verse 11-15. The rest of us are going to be have immortal bodies, and God will let us know what we're going to do after that. Then that's when we'll need to know it. Yes.
Okay. We keep hearing from all these scientists and everything about how minuscule and tiny we are in this universe.
We are.
Yes. But they
and
also
God knows, and God knows every one of us.
Right. But what's interesting is that, you know, it seems as if that the earth is actually the center of God's attention.
It is, just like Jerusalem is the center of the earth.
Heaven and the earth.
Right. Yes, right. Yes, it is. You know, it is a center, and we're just far enough away from the center to have everything work out right, and we're not too far out to be, you know, have things not work. You know, I forgot the exact numbers. I think it's 52 things have to be 19 things have to be exactly right within our solar system for life to exist on Earth. And then it is 104 or something within the galaxy, Milky Way galaxy, that had to be exactly right for life to exist just here. And then it's 50 something for the galaxy. Then it was 100 something, and now the numbers just go exponentially. There are over 850 different things in the entire universe that have to be exactly right for life to exist right here on Earth as the only place. Okay? You know, they haven't even been able to, you know, they found no place in the universe that can, you know, as far as our, you know, Hubble telescope and whatever else can see to find planets that can support life.
Yeah.
There aren't any. Although they're still trying to prove that we all came from Mars.
Yeah.
Okay. where the Martians came from. So, commentary on the short verse, another short verse. And the way of peace have they not known, meaning unregenerated man has never can never find peace with his fellow man till peace has been made with his creator. Can't have a creation without a creator. Everything's been created. You can't have, devolution. It doesn't work. We didn't evolve from rocks. Okay? Inorganic material didn't create organic material, us or any of the other creation, you know, plants, animals, etc. United Nations and other peace-oriented agencies, they are not peace organizations anymore. They have an agenda. It's a one-world government. It's coming quick. Okay? You know, the, you wanted to say something, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, the United Nations was founded on the teachings of Madame Blavatsky, who was back in the 1800s. She was the woman that Elvis Presley was always quoting.
Oh, I don't know. I don't know if she was or wasn't. Okay. I never heard him quoting anybody.
Yeah, he used to go up in front of the audience and say, you know, the writings of Madame Blavatsky. He would come up and
mention. Well,
what kind of person was she?
Satanist.
You know, the book, the you know, the book that the Passion of Christ is based on, okay, that's a mystic also,
yeah,
which is not of God.
Hello.
Okay, and you know, a Catholic friend had Pastor and I, you know, gave us tickets to go and to see that, you know, so it's all in, you know, in Aramaic, mm-hmm, yeah. Okay, you know, the good part of the movie is people don't understand the scourging of Christ. If they understood how violent that was, you know, it was, you know, I couldn't watch it. That's how violent it was. All right. If they would understand what Jesus Christ went through for us to pay our sin debt, a whole lot of people would be more humble. But it is, you know, they had Peter and John calling Mary their mother and things like this because he was Catholic. Okay, from a mystic, okay,
yeah.
Mel Gibson has his own church. He made his own church. Does Latin masses, okay, etc. And then you should hear some of the tirades that are on YouTube with his former girlfriend, who's now married to the father of a child, and you know the stuff. You know, that's part of why he kind of disappeared too. Anyway. The United Nations and other peace-oriented, put peace in quotes, agencies are doomed to failure because man is a furious animal. You know, we're all animals. We have peace to surpass our understanding. The rest of the world doesn't. That's why they hate us. You know, one of the reasons they hate us is we have peace and they don't. We have a smile on our face. They don't. Okay. They have to take care of themselves, and we have the Holy Spirit that gives us guidance and a God that takes care of us. The most savage of animals does not destroy his own species to appease his hunger. Would that be abortion? Okay, you know, wiping out their own children for their own, you know, it's going to cost money for the baby. So I just got my brand new Corvette. You know, I got to pay for that. So the baby's got to go. All right. Oh, you could use this as your Corvette too?
No. No, but I have a comment.
He raised his hand. Yes, go ahead.
Friday, we was at the Keller Center, and we was praying for a woman, and you know, and she was going there to cure her. And she had twins. And,
yeah.
And we was praying for the Lord to
Is this the one that walked away?
No, I don't think so.
Okay, because we've had numerous times where women with twins have walked away. Had one at preterm about a month ago. Who decided to keep her babies, which is good.
Amen.
So you know, it could be a Lexus, it could be a BMW, you know, all kinds of expensive cars. You know, it's just amazing what people drive in with. You know, they have, you know, and it's all about the materialism. They're loaned up to their neck, head, mm-hmm. higher, you know, and you know, with money that they owe other people in order to keep the stuff they've got. You know, they can't afford the baby. You know, mm-hmm. you don't know my circumstances. Mm-hmm. Well, if you didn't get yourself into those circumstances, you wouldn't have that problem. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they don't. They're only thinking about the here and now. They don't plan for the future. They don't. All they care about is their own pleasure. And if you get a chance to talk to them, it always goes down the same path. You don't know my circumstances. You know, I need to get my degree so I get my big job. And you know, of course, they're getting degrees in things that you can't get jobs anymore. And, you know, they're taking psychology. They're taking women's studies. things that you can't get a job in. And then they want the government to pay for it.
Yeah.
You know, is any wonder why America's gone? The most savage of animals does not destroy his own species to appease his hunger, but man destroys his fellow man for much less. You know, talking about the wars, but there's a war in the womb. You know, what crimes have the unborn children committed to require the death penalty? Nothing. Okay. Even with rape. Second act of violence doesn't satisfy. That doesn't take away the first act of violence. And most women that are on the table getting the abortion realize when it's too late, the act of violence was done against them, they're now doing to a defenseless unborn child. And that drives them crazy. Okay? They wind up with emotional problems. We have Deuteronomy 6:24. The sin of the father will be on the father. The sin of the child will be on the child. Well, why aren't you going after the rapist and not go after the child?
Right.
Okay. The world is filled with animosity. Hatred, terrorists, murders. Man will never be at peace with himself until he is at peace with God. Isaiah 59:8, verse 18. We're going too fast. You know, without your counterpart here asking questions all the time. There's no fear. There is no fear of God before their eyes. If nothing is going wrong, they don't fear God. And when something does go wrong and they get, you know, they decide to pray, oh, God, fix this, then they go back and start doing whatever they want to do afterwards. Well, sooner or later, God says, you've had your opportunity. I've shown you that I exist. I'm showing you that I'm real. I took care of your problems before, and now you're going to still walk away? Goodbye. Okay, he turns them over to a reprobate mind. Let them know he was there. That's another one of those applications Hebrews 6, verses 4 to 6. A lot of applications for that verse. Even though it starts out for, it is impossible for this stuff to occur. These people still have. God still makes himself known to people. I mean, how do we all get converted? He made us himself known. So if things are going right in their life, why should they worry about God? I got what I need. I got what I want. Or I'm going to go get it in one manner or another. So the commentary requotes it and then says, the quote is actually from Psalms 36:1. This final charge in the fountain from which all the others spring, all the characteristics of man, his lack of understanding, his unprofitableness, his lack of peace, etc., stem from the fact that man does not fear God, Psalms 36:2. Since man has no spiritual understanding, and the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Anybody remember where that is? Where it is in the Bible?
Proverbs
chapter 1?
No. The other one. That's the fear of knowledge. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge is 1:7.
1:7. Is it?
The other one. The one in the wisdom. Yes. I just said that. Proverbs, yeah. Yes. 9:10. Come on, guys. Guys got to learn some more verses. Man is caught in his vicious circle. Only the external force of the Holy Spirit of God can break the circle of man's ignorance, arrogance, and guilt. Paul presents these 14 specific writings, these 14 specifically, written counts of his indictment against the whole world. Remember, Ecclesiastes 1:9, I'll give you that first. There's nothing new under the sun. Everything is just a repeat of everything else that's been going on. Man, who was left to his own devices, is going to compete. Is going to do the same thing over and over again. If you don't learn history, then you will repeat history, right? Because there's nothing new under the sun, and Satan knows how to tempt all of us. Okay? He knows all the ways to tempt man. He and his demons can get at us. And we have to be vigilant of it, all right? We're all sinners. We're all still sinners. I gave you that testimony that, got tired of the sin. And said one day, I said, Lord, I sure do wish, I know I need a Savior. I've committed sin, I don't need to sin anymore. I'm tired of this. And what God put back in my mind was, it's not audible. And I know when it comes from Him because it's always a rhetorical question of some kind. And he said, what was the first sin? Pride.
Right.
If he took away our sin, pride would enter in and we'd be back sinners again. But yeah. We would be worse off than we were before.
Right.
Because pride is a really tough sin to get over. Claudia, you look really...
No, I was just listening to what you said. If you took away our sin, it would come back again.
Yeah.
I was just thinking
about
that.
Yeah, you were pondering so deep, I thought you
were... Oh, yeah, no, I was just thinking about that. Thanks.
You might have a question.
What did you do if I took away your sin?
Yeah, the Holy Spirit said.
Oh, and then he had me analyze it.
What was the first sin? The first sin is pride.
Okay.
It would take you down a path that you don't want to go, and it gets you harder to get you back to where you are. He keeps us humble. By us still having our sin nature, we always recognize that we need Him.
We stay
close to Him because of it. Now, hopefully the sins that we're doing are not out in the world with the world to see when we claim to be Christians. Okay?
Thank you.
That we stay righteous as much as we can. We're in a new subsection. Well, it's only one verse for the subsection. The defense on behalf of the whole world. And it's in two parts, part A. Now we know that what things soever the law says to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all of the world may become guilty before God. We are all guilty.